Welcome to the Writer's Rendezvous from the South Dakota Humanities Council.
Hi, I'm Carl Gerke of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm here at the Deadwood Mountain Grand for the 2013 South Dakota Festival of Books. And my guest is Elizabeth Cook-Lynn, and thanks so much for joining us. Now, you've done a variety of work over the years. You've been a poet, you've written fiction, and you're also a scholar. And one of your main interests is Native American Studies as an academic discipline.
Yes.
This is something that is lacking.
It's something that needs to be a part of the educational strategies. If what we're doing is trying to look at a body of information, indigenous people and their histories, and if we are looking for solutions to various political and social issues.
And if it's not treated seriously, what are the dangers that are?
Well, I think the dangers are quite obvious. What we have in this part of the country is a bunch of stereotypes about who Indians are. I mean, you got Crazy Horse up there on the mountain. Nobody knows what Crazy Horse looked like, but somebody thinks they can put a likeness of him up there. That's a war period. You know, 200 years ago we were at war. He was dead before he was 30. What are we teaching young people about indigenous history, about Indian-white relations? We're either that, we're either warriors, or we're victims of massacre, or we're drunks in the street, or we're poverty-stricken. You know, the truth of the matter is that in the 20th century, Indians have made great progress. We are scholars, we're lawyers, writers, rodeo riders, we run governments, we run schools. And yes, I think that it's time for us to change the dialogue about Indians.
Does that, when you started out as a writer, when you grew up in Fort Thompson, is that correct?
Yes.
Did you have this sort of writing in mind?
Probably not.
Mm-hmm.
When I grew up at Fort Thompson, I didn't know what I was going to do with my life. There was very little potential for me. I was a very bad scholar. I grew up in a home where two languages are spoken all the time. I grew up in a tar-papered shack with 9 people in it. We were poverty-stricken. So no, as a writer, one has to evolve.
Evolve as a writer or as a person?
As a writer.
As a writer. And as I mentioned, you've written so many different, you know, from poetry to
genres.
There you go. How do all those different genres relate to expressing that Native American history or character that you're describing?
I don't know. I don't write fiction. I don't consider myself a poet. But I'm interested in language, how language is used. I have talked a lot to a lot of writers, and one of them is Ray Youngbear, who speaks the Meskwaki language and lives in the middle of Iowa. And he told me one time, you know, writing is just an experiment with words. I think that's a good description. Because you have to like language, you have to care about how it is used, and you have to care about what it does. I went to school and learned to read English. I thought it was interesting. I wanted to write almost as soon as I learned to read. But I didn't get very far writing. I didn't publish anything until I was 40. Takes a long time to be a writer. The kind of writer I am, anyway. I think intolerant of people who say, I think I'll write a book about myself. That's not what I do. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about the world we live in. It's about politics. It's about history. So that's kind of what I'm interested in as a writer.
Do you find that sometimes that your work is often very, very, you have a point of view, a strong point of view?
Yes, and I don't have much of an audience. Nobody wants to talk about politics. I don't write because I think I have an audience. I write because I want to know some things. And a lot of people think that writers write because they know something. Writers don't know anything. Editors know even less. Publishers know nothing. So as a writer, you have to decide what it is you want to know. And so you begin to write. And you begin to analyze. And you begin to describe. And you begin to find out things. That's why I write, to find out things.
Now, you mentioned that you have you're involved with a sculpture project.
Yes.
in Rapid City. How does that relate to the work that you've done as a writer?
That's a good question. That sculpture, and we have been at it now for a year, we have 12 Native American contributors to the idea. What we thought about when we started that was we would like to change the dialogue about Indians. We are not just warriors. We're not just victims of massacre. We're not just drunks on the street. We're not just Americans. We are Indian Americans, Native Americans, which means we're tribal people. To go back to the issue of what we think that's doing, that project, we want to change the dialogue. 20th century people, Indians, have accomplished a lot. We've not only survived, but we've accomplished. Eastman was a physician. He was the only Indian doctor at Wounded Knee. Black Elk, of course, philosophy and religion. Oscar Howe, one of the most important painters of the 20th century. I grew up 3 miles from where he lived, and I know his relatives. His work hangs in embassies around the world. I don't know that there's one public painting in all of Rapid City that says who he is. And then, of course, there's Vine Deloria, who died rather recently in 05, I believe. He was a colleague of mine. And he single-handedly wrote the books that are necessary for the development of Native American studies. He probably wrote over 30 books. And they are about law, and they're about politics, and they're about history. So, I think it's time, you see, for the West, in general terms, to know who we are, really. I would like to believe that we can move on from Deadwood and all the ugly history that comes out of this place. By that I mean Deadwood became a town in 1776. Crazy Horse was killed the next year. The Black Hills was stolen the year after that. So there is a huge, huge history here. And in our part of the country. And hardly anybody knows very much about it, about us, as political, historical, learned contributors to this society.
Move beyond the stereotypes and just people of the past.
Yes, yes. Somebody contacted me in the hall just not very long ago and said, if you were going to talk about historical figures of 1800 or 1700 or whatever, who would you name? And so he began to name periods, people from the Indian War period, Sitting Bull, Struck by the Ree, all these people. And I said, well, our children do have to know that history, and that's a significant history. But we signed a treaty. It was a peace treaty. And we have to know what happened after that peace treaty. Our children have to know what happened after that. So that's kind of what I'm kind of interested in.
Well, Elizabeth Cook-Lynn, thanks so much for taking the time to talk with us.
Writer's Rendezvous is a production of SDPB.